Let's pray. We just welcome you now, Holy Spirit, our teacher tonight. We thank you for your presence that is already manifest, not only in our hearts, but in this atmosphere. And we do come now for our daily bread of the Word of God. Lord, we ask again today, what is it? The manna. What is it? What would you like to speak into our hearts today? Because we know that the entrance of your word will give us light, will dispel the darkness in our life and help us to grow into a whole new level, a whole new understanding, a new maturity in life. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to be our teacher. We acknowledge you in all of our ways. We thank you for directing our paths tonight. We thank you that you're Christ in us, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. Just lay your hands on your belly, man. Just say, hello, Holy Spirit. Amen. Hello, Holy Spirit. Now just ask him, say, be the teacher inside me. Right now, manifest out of my spirit. Illuminate my mind. Renew my mind. Do construction in my mind. We thank you for that. Amen. Amen. Sometimes we got to remember, a lot of times we're living 18 inches from God. Amen. 18 inches from God, from your spirit to your mind. You can walk through the whole day sometimes and forget he's living in you. We're crying out, God, help. And he's like, don't yell, I'm right here. Huh? Think about it. Don't yell, I'm right here. Hallelujah. We can't, you know, we started this message last week and I brought up that verse, Christ in you, the hope of glory. What an awesome thing. If there's any hope of glory, it's Christ in you. That's why Paul said it this way. He said that the communication of your faith would become effective by acknowledging every good thing in you in the Lord. Hallelujah. People are saying, God, come down. And he's like, I did 2,000 years ago. Been here ever since. Never left. And a lot of our cliches in worship, we use them because they rhyme. You know what I mean? But we can't forget that when we're singing, rain down, Lord, we're really saying rain out. Because he's in here. Amen. Pentecost already happened. Spirit of God was poured out 2,000 years ago. We're looking for tongues of fire to come from heaven. He's looking for some tongues of fire on the earth. Amen. Hallelujah. He wants the tongue of fire to be a tongue of fire in you. Every one of you. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, to this message, we're kind of looking at two things right now. Two series. One is the gifts of the Spirit. And one is the fruits of the Spirit. Amen. You got to have both. We've seen too many people with all the fruits and no gifts. And they're incomplete. Everybody say good. But incomplete. And then we see a lot of people who have gifts. But we don't see the manifestation of the fruit. Everybody say good. But incomplete. Amen. I mean, I don't know about you, but I'll never forget. I had a hero when I got saved. He was my hero. I watched him on television every week. In fact, I couldn't wait for the night that he was preaching. He was leading a massive revival. And I mean to tell you, man, I was, it's kind of the things. When I grew up spiritually, I want to be just like him. You know what I mean? And I'll never forget, I was infatuated with the gift in this guy. He was an evangelist. In fact, because of him, I wanted to be an evangelist. I wanted to be just like him. And I would sit there and just weep and cry and watch him lead the people to Christ and everything, And a couple of years went by. And then one day, lo and behold, I'm sitting in downtown Fort Worth in a Mexican restaurant across the table from this guy. We're eating dinner. I'm like, I'm sitting in front of my hero. And you know, after one dinner with him, I never wanted to hear him preach again. He had gifts, but he was completely full of himself. I've met a lot of men that I thought were awesome. To hear him speak, or to singers that sing, or, you know, teachers that teach. And then when you get to know him, you're like, really? Great gift, just no fruit. And it was funny because I was preaching a while back, and he was in the service. I didn't know he was there. And I was in another church in another state, and he came up to me afterwards. He goes, "Who are you?" And I'm like, you know what I wanted to say? "You stinking jerk, I met you a dozen times. But you so full of yourself, you didn't even know I was sitting across the table." That's what I wanted to say. But I didn't. I was cordial. I said, "I'm so-and-so from so-and-so." And, well, I won't tell you anything else, but it was just kind of funny. I'll just leave it there. Amen. But it's amazing, and I've been that way over and over and over in life. I've met a few of my heroes, and they went from hero to zero after a conversation. Amen. I don't care how gifted you are. And let me tell you something. Your gift may get you before men, but your fruit's what's going to get you before God, because he's the one that gave you the gift, and he ain't that impressed with it. Amen. So when we talk about being filled with the Holy Ghost, we got to look at both sides of this thing. I want to be as gifted as I am filled with the love of God, and I want to be filled with gifts and love and gifts. I want to walk in this walk in a balance of nature. As we said, the hymn of the priest, bell, pomegranate, bell, pomegranate, bell. So when he walked in the presence of God in the Holy of Holies, it was a walk of gift and fruit, gift and fruit, gift and fruit. Amen. And I want to tell you, man, I experienced something when I was a young Christian. And I know because of this experience, the Bible says the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. This is a love that's not human. It's a different kind of love. You know, I remember 30 years ago reading E.W. Kenyon's book on the two kinds of love. And you know, there's a love that humans can express, but then there's a love that goes beyond any explanation. It's a love that reaches out further than human love can reach. It's a love that forgives when human love is bankrupt of forgiveness. There's a love that gives when human effort is extinguished. I mean, you're done. You're used up. But there is a love that powerful. And I got one of my first doses of it. I'd been praying. And in fact, I think if I remember, right, it's been so many years, it's hard to keep them all straight. But I think it was out of that book, The Two Kinds of Love, that we had it in one of our Bible college courses. And I was praying, saying, "God, I just want to love people." And before Christ, I didn't love everybody. Didn't even like a lot of folks. But it wasn't that easy. And I was, you know, just nasty. And so I'm praying. Well, one night we were in a conference in my home church, and Kenneth Hagin was preaching, senior. And I was sitting in the front row there where I always sat, and he was walking back and forth, you know, doing his thing. And some of you young people don't even know who Kenneth Hagin is. But he was a man that God used to bring the word of faith back into the church, and the guy was used around the world to get people to walk in faith again. Powerful, powerful man of God. And he was one guy that I met, and he was really cool. He was not a jerk. He was very introverted, but he wasn't a jerk. So he's walking back and forth, and I'm just sitting there in this auditorium. There's probably 1,500 people there, and there was this big dome in the auditorium. The ceiling was 80 feet in this auditorium, just a big dome. It was a round auditorium, Pastor Bob's church down in Fort Worth. And I'm sitting in that seat, and all of a sudden, while he's just walking along teaching, I heard a sound. My ears opened to the spirit realm. And it sounded like I was sitting outside in the woods in a heavy rain. I could hear the water hitting. I could hear the water dropping like in puddles. I could hear it coming through the trees. And all of a sudden, I felt this. It just felt like something hit me right in the top of the head, just like somebody take their finger and pop right on top of my head. And I turned around to the person behind me, and they're looking at me like, what are you looking at, you know? And I realized it wasn't them. And as that thing hit the top of my head, I looked back and I looked, and all of a sudden it felt like honey was just running over my head. And as it got like to my eyes, it's like my vision changed. And as it got over me, this warm, ooey, gooey, shmooey, fooey, feeling, fuzzy, wuzzy, lovey, kissy. This feeling came over me, and literally, I just love everybody. Dude, it was not me, because I had never felt like that before. And I mean, I'm looking around, and it was like everybody, I was seeing everybody through another set of eyes. And all of a sudden, I said, Holy Spirit, what is that? And just as clear and as loud as a trumpet inside me, he said, that's some of that love you've been asking for. And man, I'll never forget. There was a lady, her name was Linda. We were best of friends. We went out and witnessed all the time together. We had a witnessing team, and we were always out on the streets together. She was quite a bit older than me, but we were just good friends. And Linda was standing right over by the door. And after the service, man, I'm just hugging everybody, just loving everybody. I just love you. And I remember I walked up to Linda, and I just hugged her, and I just kissed her on the cheek. I ain't never done that in my life. I was completely not myself. It was amazing. And that began, you know, that feeling taught me something. We can get more love through the power of the Holy Spirit than we're capable of, than is normally or naturally within us. We can get baptisms of love. We really can. Now you got to ask. And here we were last week looking, you know, Jesus said, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I've loved you. And then he told us one of the definitions of that love was, no greater love hath a man than this, that he lay down his life for a friend. Now before my baptism of love, I considered, well, that's martyrdom. You know, Jesus died for my sins. And one day the Lord spoke to me. He said, life, son, your life, not just your body. That means you do stuff for people that need something done. That means you help people that need help. It means instead of doing what you want to do on a given time and someone you know has a need, just lay your life down, put your life over here, and go over and be a blessing to someone. Amen. No matter what that is. And here, if you really want to go a step further in this, do it in secret. Do it in secret. If you really want to get, if you want to get into God's serious bonus packages, do it in secret. Because there you're signing into a bonus system, man, that's beyond anything you can imagine. Where literally, water, a drink of water will get you a prophet's reward. Son, if that ain't a bonus, I'm not a prophet. Okay, you want a prophet's reward? Yeah. give a bottle of water in the name of a prophet. Jesus said, if you give a drink of water in the name of a prophet, you get a prophet's reward. Now, the prophet will be up in heaven saying, what's he doing with my reward? You know what the Lord's going to say? The same thing he said about the laborers in the orchard. What is it to you if I just want to be that good? Huh? Because don't complain, because, yeah, you may be a prophet, but I might just give you an evangelist reward. I just like to give rewards when people do things believing that I would. The more we do to walk in this level of love, this level of love that goes beyond human, the greater our reward will be in heaven. And I'm telling you, man, it's so real. There are going to be so many people in front of you, and you're going to wonder, why are you in front of me? And the Lord's going to tell you. You remember when you did that great thing on earth and you thought, man, I really stepped it up for God? Remember all them folks saying, wow, that was awesome. Well, that was your reward. But these people over here, they did it in secret. And now I'm going to reward them openly. It takes a faith that has to be born of the heart of God, because it's bigger than human faith, to be able to love like that. Because our love so many times is really in a benefit exchange. That's why Jesus said, you speak to people who speak to you, human. Speak to people that won't speak to you. You know, I moved into a neighborhood at one point in my life, and I was not really welcomed, I guess, and I would wave at people, and they wouldn't wave back. Everybody was just like, hey. And I just, oh, this is fun. I'm going to really work this. And, you know, it took a couple years to get them to wave back at me. A couple of years. Amen. A couple of years. That's why he said, do good to them that, how about this, despitefully. Now, it's one thing to be used. It's another thing to be despitefully used, lied about, persecuted, spoken evil of falsely. Think about that. Jesus said, bless them. Don't curse, bless them. Bless them. I had a warlock put a curse on me one time, and I was in the... I'd heard someone else do this. I just thought it sounded cool. So when the curse came, and it came, a demon came after me. And it made me sick, puking sick. And I'll never forget. I just said, in the name of Jesus, I reverse the curse. I reverse the curse. I reverse the curse. Sounded good. Sounds pretty spiritual to me. Amen. And that guy was in a car wreck that night, and he died, and they resuscitated him. And I'll never forget when that report came back to me, the Spirit of God rebuked me and said, you almost killed that man. He said, son, I didn't call you to curse, but to bless those who curse you. Now, this takes another kind of love right here. It's easy to bless them that bless you. That's what Jesus said. Ain't no godly, there ain't no divine life in somebody's good to me, I'll be good to them. He said, don't invite people that you know are just going to invite you back. Let's see, I'll take him to lunch this week, he'll take me to lunch next week. He said, invite someone you know can't take you to lunch. Invite someone. My mind's just being flooded right now. I'm having to shut down memories because I've done stuff over the years to prove this stuff, and I don't want to tell you because I don't lose my reward. So I'm just shutting them down. Stop it. Shut up. Memories go back. You know, it's hard when you're trying to live as an example to teach, because I got to have some secrets too. Amen. Because I want some bigger rewards than a pat on the back from a human. I'm looking for some of them heavenly rewards, some of the big boys. Amen. Now let's go to Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. I'm going to read from the Amplified. If then you've been raised with Christ to a new life, thus sharing his resurrection from the dead, aim at and seek the rich eternal treasures that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds, keep them set on what is above, the higher things, not on the things that are on the earth. Man, that takes faith. That takes faith. Isn't it hard every day when we're living and doing our life to keep heavenly minded, to keep remembering that everything we're experiencing on this earth is temporal? It's only for a season. You know, it's only for a season. It's only, it's here a little while like a cloud. Man, we had some clouds this week, didn't we? And then the day I walked outside, it was just clear blue skies. And I'm like, wow, all those clouds are just gone. And that's the way things in this life are. But the things that are there are eternal. To stay heavenly minded is the greatest walk of faith there is. Not to get bogged down in the mire of this earth. Not to get bogged down into the mud of life. But to keep our attitude right. To keep doing what's right when there are no applauses. When there is no, you know, pat on the back. When there seems to be no reward for what you just did. Remembering and keeping your faith connected to a higher life. Higher life. He said, as far as this world is concerned, you're dead. You're dead. You have died in your life. Your new life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, you will appear with him in the splendor of his glory. You know, I was watching the news the other day, and President-elect Trump was walking through a factory out here in Indiana, Carrier Air Conditioning, and they showed this picture. And he's coming down through there, man, and he had an entourage of like 30 people, you know, high up CEOs, Secret Service, all these important people. He's just strutting down through there, and he's got his entourage. And man, that's something on earth. To be with the president. Guys, we're going to be the entourage of God Almighty. My God. That's going to be a big entourage. Heaven's a big place. We're going to be his entourage. Think about that. You know, my experience in heaven help me understand that all the part of our nature that is competitive stays right here. Our motives, once we leave this body, our motives become so pure. And so, because some people would think, well, if there's that many people, how much time am I going to get to spend with Jesus? If there's, hey, he works it all out, believe me. But that thought will never enter your mind once you're out of your body. I've been out of my body, and I've been in heaven, and the thought never enters your mind about anything that's selfish stays here. The only thing I experienced in heaven that would be called not satisfied was a hunger to learn and to know and to understand, and that was only from the purest of motive. Just a hunger for understanding. I just want to know more about you. Why do you do what you do? Not because I'm complaining about what you did. I just want to understand it. I just want to understand it. That's such an experience. I wish everyone could experience what I experienced in that time. So you just have to take my word for it and the word of all these cloud of witnesses, people who have had the wonderful experience of being there. But we all still walk by faith. Because I'm going to tell you something. That was an incredible experience I had in my life. But let me tell you, when you're in the quagmire of life, a dream, a vision, a visitation, a visit to heaven, those things can be clouded real quick by the reality of living on planet Earth. Planet heaven can get choked out of your memories real quick. That's why we see people have glorious visitations of God, incredible deliverances, wonderful salvations and baptisms of fire and the Holy Spirit. And oh my God, this is unreal. And then 6 months later, they're back in the mud. Amen. So those experiences really don't keep us, but they do encourage us. Amen. So he says, so when Christ, who is our life, appears, we'll appear with him in the splendor of his glory. So look at verse 5. Kill. Deaden. Deprive of power. The evil desire lurking inside your members. Kill the beast. Woke you up, didn't I? Turn on your neighbor and say, kill the beast. Kill it. Kill it. Yeah. Two to the heart, one to the head. Make sure that sucker is dead. Put a hit out on the old man inside you. That thing rises up inside you. Well, they're taking advantage of me. Kill the beast. Oh, I can't believe they did that to me. Kill the beast. You can even pimp shoot him if you want. Hold your gun sideways. Kill the beast. Kill the beast. You can Western it. However you want to do it. Kill. Kill. Mortify. Kill. Deprive of power the evil lurking inside your members. Those animal impulses with all that is earthly in you. All that is employed in sin. Like it's your job. Like it's your job. A boy sins like it's his job. Remember, your old man is... He's into the unemployment line now. There should be a mortuary, you know. I like what, as Pastor Brian always used to say, that problem with that old man is he keeps wanting to climb up out of the grave. He keeps wanting to resurrect out of the grave. Grave robbing, he said, is a crime in West Virginia. It's a crime to rob a grave, so we got to keep that thing dead. Amen? Because it is ever ready. Listen to this. Here it is. Sexual vice, impurity, sensual. Sensual appetites, unholy desires, all greed, covetousness, for that is idolatry. How about this one? The deifying of self and other created things instead of God. On account of these very sins, that the very holy anger of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, those who are obstinately. I love the Amplified Bible. Why? Because sometimes I'm hard of hearing. You know, it's one thing to say, mortify the deeds of your body. It's another thing to say, kill it, murder it, deprive it. Amen. Love it. It was translated by a woman. You know, sometimes women just say something more than they should have. I hear. But it's good. It's good. I think sometimes the woman said, let me show you how to translate the Bible. You men been messing this thing up for years. Let me show you how to do this. I'm just joking with you. Amen. So I'm sorry, but all dogs don't go to heaven. And there is a holy anger of God coming upon. Okay, this is going to hurt for, if you're watching online, most of the folks here already know how this thing works. But if you're watching online, sons of disobedience. God had to go and include the family in this. In other words, his sons who are in disobedience. Well, I believe in Jesus. Should have killed the beast. God, what's this happening to me for? Should have killed the beast. Amen. Come on. That's what it says. I didn't make this up. Well, he wasn't really talking about his sons. Okay, well, whose sons was he talking about? He didn't say the devil's children here. This is written to the church. Think about it. So he goes on to say, those who obstinately oppose the divine will, among whom you once also walked. Everybody say past tense. I got to stop this mess. That's what repentance, you know, we talked about the reset button and some exhortation and prophetic words tonight. Hitting that reset button. Repentance is that reset button. He said, you got to change some things in your identity. Well, if you push this button, you're going to have to change some things. Amen. That's what repentance is about. He said, these very sins. He said, among whom you also once walked when you were living in and addicted to such practices. Now, there's a difference between making a mistake or living as a mistake. This is the difference between missing the mark in sin. And folks, we do this. I'm not telling you you're losing your salvation every time you slip up and do something. But I'm telling you, you can't live in habitual practice of these sins and think that there isn't coming. The judge is coming to judge this stuff. I remember when I was in Bible college, one of our instructors had made a statement. He said, think of it like this. You're a Christian, right? Yes. You've been delivered, right? Yes. He said, now think about this. This is sin. This is sin. God's going to judge sin, right? He's going to judge it. Now, if you happen to be in it, when the judgment comes, you're caught up in the judgment of that sin. So repentance is stepping away from the practice or the habitual lifestyle of the thing. Amen? We don't live in condemnation, guilt, and shame because we had an evil thought. But Kenneth Hagin used to say, he said, you know, you can't stop a thought. But he said, it's like a bird. You can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can stop it from building a nest in your hair. So that's how we got to live. We got to live this way. He goes on to say, now put away from yourself all these things. Now he gets personal. Anger. Rage. Bad feeling toward others. That's a hard one. You know who I don't like? And it's not hard to not have a bad feeling towards someone that I'm walking okay with. It's when we have disagreements. And that bad feeling, we've got to go back and judge the feeling. Is there a right reason for this wrong feeling? Why? There is a righteous anger. There is a righteous jealousy. I trap people all the time. I say, how many of y'all know God? You know, how many of y'all know sin is, or jealousy is a sin? And everybody lifts their hands. I said, no, it ain't. God is jealous. In fact, he even said, that's my name. Jealous. There's a righteous jealousy and there's an unrighteous jealousy. There's a righteous anger. That's not what it's speaking of. There's an unrighteous anger. Righteous anger just simply means I get mad about what God gets mad about. Unrighteous anger is when I get mad and God ain't mad. If I'm mad at something that God's not mad at, now I have an unrighteous anger. So our anger is qualified by his word and his spirit. You know, there's sometimes I get up and preach, especially on Sundays, because we have a bigger, you know, this is a disciple night. Sundays is more of a mixed multitude. And there's some Sundays I get up and preach and I go home and I'm like, I feel inside this two people, and I sense where the righteous indignation of God bled through. The Dave nice guy didn't want to say what I said, and I literally, when I go home and that anointing lifts, I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe I said that. And I know that was God, because I would have never said it that way. I'd have never said it that way. Not in a million years. That's not me. But the Spirit of God, you know, when that gift, that apostolic anointing comes, there's an authority that I can't stop. It comes out, and it's like, it scares me. I'm serious. When you're flowing in the anointing in your gift, you go back and you go, that was good. I'm going to take some notes on myself. Because you realize it's not you. It's that anointing that abides in you. Amen. But boy, we've got to make sure. So he says, we've got to begin to and keep walking in this. Put away anger, rage. That's where you get mad and cuss someone out. Run somebody off the road. Shoot somebody. Amen. There are crazy people out there. Rage. Bad feeling towards other. Curses and slander and foul-mouthed abuse and shameful utterances from your lips. That just covers about everything you shouldn't say, doesn't it? Huh? You could throw dirty jokes in there. Crude, nasty, dirty jokes. He says, don't lie to one another, for you've stripped off the old unregenerate self with its evil practices, and you've clothed yourselves with the new spiritual self, which is ever, here's the good news, in the process of being renewed and remolded into fuller and more perfect knowledge. Knowledge after the image of the likeness of him who created it. And in this new creation, all distinctions vanish. There's no room for, and there cannot be any more, Jew or Greek, circumcised, uncircumcised. No difference between nations, whether alien, barbarian, Scythians, who are the most savage of all. No slave, no free, but Christ is in all, and all, everything and everywhere to all men without distinction of person. Clothe yourselves, therefore, as God's own chosen ones, his own picked representatives, who are purified and holy and well-beloved by God himself, by putting on behavior. When I first got saved, I used to feel like I was faking it when I tried to live a Christian life. Because there was so much of that old me, you know, the memories were so present. And I would feel like if I tried to be nice to someone, I remembered Dave, the old guy, and I would think, you're faking it. And I would have to talk myself. I would have to coach myself. No, you're putting on behavior that is marked. How many of y'all put on some clothes today? You could have ran around naked. You didn't wake up in the morning and say, God, if you don't want me naked, clothe me. And walked on outside and seen if any clothes appeared on you. And the Detective Nangle would have picked you up, taken you down, took you out to Tri-County, and could have had a nice day. Well, in the same way, you don't say, I'm going to give this person a piece of my mind. That's what you feel like doing. That's what everything inside you, that's you. No, no, no. Kill the beast. That's the old you. Now you got to put on. Bless you. You ever, you know, it's a busy day at Walmart, you're in Christmas traffic, and you're in a hurry, and the kids are fuss, and you go to whip in that parking place, and this guy whips right in before you. Bless you. I was saving that spot for you. Have a nice day. When inside you, you're wanting to, jerk! I have to put on behavior at times. Huh? I have to put on behavior. Are you faking it? No, I'm being the new me. Faking it? No, I'm putting on new behavior. Well, I knew you before, and that was not you. You're right. Amen. So, be gentle. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, my goodness. It gets worse. Marked by tender-hearted pity and mercy. Kind feeling. A lowly opinion of yourself. Don't you love the Amplified Bible? Gentle ways and patient, which is tireless and long-suffering and has the power to endure whatever comes with a good temper. My wife did not believe, I don't think, I was real until she saw me in the positions where I typically would have blown a gasket and broken something. And I'm like, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It's going to be all right. And she's like, who are you? Because she was used to me throwing things, hitting things, kicking things, breaking things. I used to break the furniture up at night and then glue it back together in the morning. It was cheap furniture. I remember punching the furniture and breaking the furniture and taking hammers and beating on my car. And now I'm just, hallelujah. Praise him. You know, if you really want to get mad, just shout the victory. Come on. Isn't this good? Turn around and tell somebody, I'm just enjoying this. See, when you get done with this, you're ready for an altar call. You're ready to say, help! Help me, Father, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. Live this way. Oh man, it gets better. He says, keeping this long suffering, the power to endure. Okay, verse, be gentle and forbearing with one another. This is one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible. If anyone has a difference, a grievance, or a complaint against another, readily pardoning each other. Wow. Even as the Lord has freely forgiven you, so must you also forgive. And put on love and enfold yourselves with the bond of perfectness, which binds everything together completely in ideal harmony. And let soul peace, the harmony which comes from Christ, rule and act as umpire in your hearts, deciding and settling with all finality all questions that arise in your minds, in that peaceful state to which, as members of Christ, one body, you were called to live. And now, be thankful. Is there any more? Is there anything else you would like tonight, Jesus? You're already telling me to act like a saint. I don't know what kind of song you can come up with after this message. Let's see what you got. Let's see what you got, team. Come on. No pressure. Follow this one up. Think about it. Man, guys. How many of y'all ready to pray? Now I want everyone to act like this tonight and forever. I'm just messing with you. Think about it. This is our high calling. High calling in Christ Jesus. Now you think about, I can prophesy. Yeah, but can you do this? I cast out a devil. But can you do this? Can I say it is easier to develop a prophetic anointing than it is to live like this? With everybody, every day, out loud, when you're awake. I had a dream last night. I was acting just like that. Oh, stand up tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Let's sing a song and console ourselves. Oh, hallelujah. Not asking for much, is he? Not any more than he's given. Inside you is the ability, inside me is the ability to live this life.